of water, earth, and sky. The heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. Lord of heaven and earth. Lord of heaven and earth.
Well, hello and good morning. Welcome to worship here for Lucan Presbyterian Church on the 18th of October 2020. Actually, it's the 17th of October as I'm recording this. It's Saturday morning, and NPHET are briefing the government right now about potential new restrictions that might come into force in our country. It means that the future looks pretty bleak in terms of church life. And I know that you, like me, are really missing the normality of a Sunday morning where we can go down to the church and meet together to worship God in perfect freedom. Never before have the words of the psalmist been more relevant. When I used to go to the house of the Lord under the protection of the Almighty, singing praise among the festive throng. And I really miss going down to church on a Sunday morning, parking up by number four, coming into church, meeting those early arrivers and getting things ready for the service, watching people file in and chat and hug, embrace and get ready for a service of worship together. We haven't been able to do that for so many weeks and months, and I'm really longing for that. But for now, we have to do what we have to do, and that is stay apart, wash our hands, mask up, look out for one another, protect our health service and protect one another as we move through this pandemic together. But I long for the day, and it will come, and it will come soon, when we will be able to meet together and worship with perfect freedom. But for now, we continue to do this thing where we meet together online to worship God and hear from his word and connect with each other as best as possible. And we're trying to keep church life moving as best as we can with home groups and discipleship groups and youth work and children's work and some pastoral support as well. And I hope that you're able to engage with that as best as possible. We have a great service for you this morning. Dorothy is going to be leading us in prayers for others. And the Crocker Duns have put together a fantastic dramatized reading of Romans chapter 12 as we consider what it is to love the Lord our God with all our minds. So looking forward to seeing that played out later in the service. But for now, we're going to come into the place of worship, and we're going to use the words of Psalm 46, "Be still and know that I am God." And in a news cycle that is full of bad news and makes us feel all sorts of emotions, fight, flight, and shutdown, we can draw close to God and still ourselves and know that he is God. So as Claire leads us in this piece of worship, why don't we join with her? The words will be on the screen as we sing to the Lord and still ourselves before him in praise and worship.
Thank you.
Now, a few announcements. Today is a busy day for us in LPC. We're starting something new. Today at 3 o'clock, there's going to be 2 Zoom groups for our children who are in primary school age, those who would have been in J Club and Spy Kids. And we're wanting you to come together on Zoom just to catch up with each other, connect with one another, and hear something from God's Word. So myself and Alex, we're going to be running a Zoom class for 25 minutes at 3 o'clock for those of you who are in first and third class. And Ryan and Inga are going to be doing the same thing at the same time in a different Zoom room for those of you who are in fourth to sixth class. And this is just a way for you to Zoom in with your friends from church, find out how they're doing, see one another, and the leaders there will pray for you, chat with you, and read something from the Bible in way of encouragement for you. So come along to that. And if you're a parent or a grandparent of children in primary school age, please do make an effort for your children to Zoom in to those 2 classes. The details are just on the screen right now. So take a note of that. And I sent it out as a WhatsApp message to many of you yesterday. So do come along to that. And then SNT is on at 7:30 tomorrow evening, and that's Ryan, Francesca, Rory, and Emmanuel. And they're starting a 7-part series working through the NUA program produced by Scripture Union Ireland. And it's a great program looking at many of the big questions, and it's very well produced. So come along to that at 7:30 tonight, SNT, until 8:30, 9 o'clock. Now, every week I send out a message to someone who I think might be willing to do a reading for our online service. And I buzzed the message out to the Crocker Duns earlier in the week, asking them if they would read from Romans chapter 12. And they went way over and above what they had to do and decided to dramatize the reading for us from Romans 12 as narrated from the message. So big thanks to them for all the effort they put into this. And it's really good and actually quite good fun as well. So listen to this as we consider what it is to love the Lord our God with everything that we have. So thanks to you guys for putting this together.
So here's what I want you to do. God helping you, take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering, embracing what God does for you is the best thing you can do for Him. Don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize that what He wants from you and quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity. God brings out the best of you, develops well-formed maturity in you. I'm speaking to you out of deep gratitude for all that God has given to me, and especially as I have responsibilities in relation to you. Living then, as everyone of you does, in pure grace, it's important that you do not misinterpret yourselves as people who are bringing this goodness to God. No, God brings it all to you. The only accurate way to understand ourselves is by what God is and by what He does for us, not by what we are and what we do for Him. In this way, we are like the various parts of a human body. Each part gets its meaning from the body as a whole, not the other way around. The body we're talking about is Christ's body of chosen people. Each of us finds our meaning and function as part of his body. But as a chopped off finger or as a cut off toe, we wouldn't amount to much, would we? So since we find ourselves fashioned into all these excellently formed and marvellously functioning parts of Christ's body, let's just go ahead and be what we were made to be, without enviously or pridefully comparing ourselves with each other or trying to be something we're not.
Hello, I've really missed you all, but let's pray together. Father, thank you that during these times there are some things that don't change and some things that COVID can't take from us. Thank you for the way the leaves are changing colour on the trees. Thank you for the way there are berries and the birds come and it's really lovely, and the crispy smell that's out there in October. Thank you that all this reminds us of you and how beautiful you make things. Father, we pray for Rachel and her family. We were sad to hear that her dad died. Father and grandfather, all deeply missed. Pray that you'll comfort Rachel and her family. And you know how difficult it is to grieve during these strange times. So we pray that they'll have the support that they need and that they'll feel your loving, caring arms around them. Pray for those in our congregation who contracted COVID. Pray that they will breathe well, and their symptoms will subside quickly, and there won't be any complications, that you'll bring them healing. And we pray for those that are caring for them. We pray that you'll give them the energy and the encouragement that they need to keep going. Father, we pray for young people as well, young people in our church and young people in our country, as it's been really tough for them, leaving certs cancelled and the start of college being so odd, and them in general just not being able to see their friends and get the social contact and support that they really need at that age. So pray for them, pray for any of them that are really depressed and are feeling hopeless, that you will give them hope and that you will provide them with the things that they need. Pray for services to be available to those that really need them, and pray that they would reach out in that way. Father, pray for our older adults as well, in isolation, cocooning on their own, and a lot of the stuff that they would have done that was part of their daily routines now gone. Pray for their mental health. Pray for their physical health. We pray for the mental health of this entire country as it is taking a battering in this time. Father, we pray for those in our congregation who sink into depression. Pray that you'd lift them out as you do, and that you give them hope and that you'll give them joy and they'll be able to sense you around them. Father, as a congregation, help us to love each other well and mind each other well in these really weird times. Inspire us. Show us things we can do that maybe we haven't even thought of. Thank you for belonging to you. Thank you that we do belong. And sometimes in COVID, you can feel like you don't belong anywhere, especially when you're on your own. So thank you that we belong to you and we as a congregation belong to each other. Thank you that you love us so much. And I pray that each member of the community would experience that love from head to toe. And we pray for a great move of your Holy Spirit amongst our country, that now that things have quietened, that people will hear your voice and respond to you and have the amazing life that is in you, just of being secure and of being loved. We ask all these things in your precious name. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
What if you could take a drug that would make you smarter and allow you to use 100% of your brain all the time? Well, the 2011 film Limitless describes that very scenario for one man. After taking this super drug, he writes a whole book in an afternoon, becomes a financial genius, and seems to have all the right answers, knowing exactly what to do in any and every situation. Our society values the mind. We care about education, intellect, reason, logic, and the ability to discover and learn knowledge. However, at times, that love of the mind and being in the pursuit of knowledge seems to come under fire within the Christian faith. For example, we might be tempted to think that faith is supremely about feelings and isn't rational like science classes or mathematical equations. This leaves skeptics holding to a view of Christianity that lacks knowledge and allows Christians to hold to a faith all about feelings and what we sense, but disregarding of facts and reason. J.P. Moreland writes that people might believe that religious claims are neither factual in nature nor subject to rational evaluation if we major on feelings and senses. Well, Mark 12, verse 30, continues the greatest commandment with emphasizing loving God with the mind. The Greek word for mind is dionia, meaning the mind is the faculty of understanding, feeling, and desiring. The aspect of feeling and desire when describing the mind can seem strange when we hear that. We'd be tempted to put thinking, feeling, and doing into different compartments, separate from each other, never touching. However, ancient writers realized that each of these areas of life could and should be integrated and interconnected. You'll also notice that the Shema prayer in Deuteronomy 6:5, which Jesus is quoting, does not include the word mind. It says, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and strength." You see, the Hebrews viewed the heart, soul, and strength of a person as having the ability to think and gain knowledge. For example, the Apostle Paul shows that the biblical writers believed that the human heart was more holistic. In the heart, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Paul says that you can believe in the resurrection, including the reason and the logic of it, in your heart. But Jesus in Mark 12:30 adds the word mind. And as we read this, we then need to know that the mind is a place of worship. The mind is as much a place of worship as the heart and the soul. Backing this up, Paul, right throughout his letters, emphasizes the importance of the renewal of the mind and the pursuit of truth and understanding. Paul tells the Ephesians, for example, to be renewed in the spirit of your minds. For the Philippians, he prays that your love may abound more and more with knowledge and discernment, so that you may approve what is excellent. And to the Roman church, he writes, "Do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." Paul wants to emphasize resisting a fallen and wicked world, to resist the fallenness and wickedness of the world. This emphasis reflects his early description of the broken world in Romans 1. Paul writes that when humanity, you and I, reject the knowledge of God, we are given over to a depraved mind. It's Romans 1:28. There is a relationship between the depraved mind and the wickedness that plagues the world. When we are shaped by one, the other happens within us. Therefore, Paul argues that it is important and vital for Christians to have transformed minds that are counter-cultural and not of this world. A transformed mind happens when, as one commentator puts it, the Christian refuses the norms of conduct employed by a sinful world, reaffirming for himself the spiritual norms befitting the redeemed. Aiding this process is the renewing of your mind, which seems to mean that the believer is to keep going back in his thoughts to the original commitment. As we live in a sinful world, and we do, we are to every day reaffirm the truth of God's grace, to continually bring to our minds the truth of God when we're confronted with the truth that's presented in this world. As we read in 2 Corinthians, we should take every thought captive to obey Christ. God cares about truth, knowledge, and wisdom as much as he cares about our feelings and our emotions. And he wants us to understand him and understand who he is in this changing world around us. Now, we can't avoid the influences of the world we live in. We are saturated in this world. Media, music, fashion, opinion. But we must discern in that what is potentially shaping our thinking. Are we so saturated in this world that we have conformed to it? For it can lead us to sin, to think and act against God and his holiness. So as we live in this world, we need to be careful that we are not transformed and shaped by it, but rather we are the transformative power within it. So believers with transformed and renewed minds, we seek to transform and renew this world we live in, that his kingdom might come in heaven, as on earth as it is in heaven, through each of us. So how do we love God with all our minds? Well, that list could be exhaustive, the how-to list, but let me highlight three things for us today. If you want to be transformed by the renewing of your mind and love God with all your mind, then the first thing I would say to you is you have to stop waiting for a miracle to change your mind. Now, don't get me wrong. We need miracles, but they alone do not change our minds without our humility and willingness to make God's word the standard for our lives. Remember, the same sun that melts the ice also hardens the clay. Look at the passage in Romans 12 again. We must play a personal and active part. We must put our own living selves, our sleeping, eating, walking around lives on the altar of God's grace in order to realize this renewal. Yes, God by his Spirit helps us, but we must take control. We must take the thoughts captive. We must actively come under his word. We, as living sacrifices, must place ourselves on the altar. God will help, but we take the action. So don't wait for the miracle completely apart from yourself to have your mind renewed. Secondly, be careful what you feed your mind with. Apparently 95% of our behaviors are automatic. That's why we set goals, but we don't reach them. Setting goals is the function of the conscious mind, but reaching them is the task of the subconscious mind. The subconscious mind occupies most of your brain. It does not work by logic. Therefore, it believes anything that it's told repeatedly by the conscious mind. So if we're repeatedly told something that is not true, we start to believe that it is true. I've noticed on social media that the more influential a person is, the less people they follow, the less others they listen to and are influenced by. Check that out for yourself on Instagram or Facebook or Twitter. Well-known influencers will only follow a relatively small group of people compared to those who follow them. The more we feed our mind with everyone else's thoughts and opinions, the more influenced we become, and we can lose ourselves in the process. As Christians who seek to have renewed minds, we should strive to follow only one, not to follow the world and all its voices, but to follow one and his voice. As the Shema prayer says, as it starts, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one." We follow this one God most closely, so his values, his morals, his law becomes our most significant influence. His voice is the one we hear most clearly. And then thirdly, we should confess what we believe, not what we feel. Yes, it is important to share how we feel. Of course, we must share how we feel. We must share ourselves with one another. And particularly in areas around mental health, we should be quick to speak and reach out to one another and listen to each other about how we're feeling. But it is so powerful when evil thoughts attack your mind to open your mouth and to speak in line with God's word. There's power in that. Not to let your feelings determine your current circumstances. As it says in Joel 3 verse 10, let the weak say, I am strong. You might not feel strong, but you are strong in the Lord. So do not always speak what you feel all the time. Otherwise your mind can't change and your feelings start to shape your reality. Confess what you believe. Confess who you are in God. So I hope that as you consider what it means for you to be an all-in believer, all-in in your love for God, your heart, soul, and mind, that you'll choose to love him with all your mind, being transformed in thought and knowledge toward a greater and fuller experience of him in your everyday, ordinary, and extraordinary lives. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship and friendship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Get the chance.